HarperCollins and Harper Audio present The Power of Teamwork by Brian Goldman. Performed by Brian Goldman. To Elaine Bromley, whose tragic story inspired me to write this book. Introduction. Teamwork. A group of individuals is not a team. Do you work on a team? For most of us, that's as banal a question as you'll get. People in all walks of life talk about the importance of teamwork. In sports, it's the difference between winning and losing. At Fortune 500 companies, teamwork builds trust and fosters creativity, collaboration, and risk-taking. In journalism, teamwork reduces errors and increases engagement with readers, radio and podcast listeners, and TV viewers. A team may begin as a group of individuals who have different skills and experience and come from different backgrounds. But a group is not a team. To be a team, these individuals must be interdependent in terms of knowledge, abilities, and the materials they work with. And they must work together to achieve a shared goal. Many of us believe we work in teams because we work in groups. Sports franchises may be stacked with superstars yet never compete for the championship because they are no more than a group of talented individuals bent on pursuing individual awards. Other teams are made up of more mediocre talent, yet win titles consistently because they set aside individual achievement in favor of team goals. With professional sports teams, the whole may be much more successful than the sum of its parts. Team players leverage the talents of individual members. They complement one another. They help each other realize their true potential and create an atmosphere that encourages everyone to do better. You don't have to play professional sports to know what I'm talking about. At your office, the people you work with constitute a group and not a team if they spend most of their time competing against one another for attention, plum assignments, and accolades. It's not a team if only some members are acknowledged at meetings. It's not a team if the leader shuts down discussion when members ask difficult questions about departmental goals and strategies. It's not a team if regular meetings are the place where intriguing ideas go to die. Once a pattern of anti-teamwork is established, it becomes a vicious cycle. You develop interpersonal habits that inhibit teamwork. You're insecure about the achievements of others because they are not seen as team achievements. Instead of teammates, you see rivals. At meetings, you want to outshine them. If that means criticizing others or snuffing out even helpful suggestions, so be it. You may be thinking this is just the way things are, but you're wrong. Team-spiritedness can be kindled, but it requires conscious effort and a leap of faith. Recently, I went to a story meeting for White Coat Black Art, the CBC radio show I've hosted for 15 years. The show mixes field pieces with studio interviews that revolve around the experience of patients, their loved ones, and health professionals in the context of modern medicine. Everyone is supposed to come to these weekly meetings with new and fresh ideas for stories. They prep for the meeting by scouring news sources and by working their contacts for ideas, which they then pitch to the group. In a team culture, the other members of the team ask questions that sharpen the focus and help refine the pitch into a decent story idea for the show. That's the theory. In practice, these meetings may reveal cracks in team cohesion. For one reason or another, story meetings can be showcases for rivalries within the group. There are many reasons for this, but the big one, in my opinion, is the tendency to fret about mistakes, to single out shortcomings while failing to recognize the unique talents and contributions of everyone on the team. In that sort of culture, everyone gets a meager ration of praise until one mistake or another knocks them down a peg or two. It makes group members sensitive to criticism and defensive at story meetings. And it's for that reason that they become reluctant to make comments and suggestions. The team begins to fail. As the only physician in a room full of journalists, my own insecurities have often made me wary of being contradicted on medical facts. I carried that insecurity into a recent story meeting with my team. For some time now, Canada has experienced a severe shortage of acute care nurses who work in emergency rooms, ERs, operating rooms, ORs, and intensive care units, ICUs. The shortage and the reasons for it have attracted lots of news coverage. Our show producer wanted pitches for stories that showed the impact of nurse shortages on the healthcare system. I had heard about a small hospital in rural Ontario at which a shortage of ER nurses meant the hospital's CEO had to close the ER for most of a holiday weekend. My pitch was to do a field piece in which I visited the hospital to interview the CEO and the people working there. "You aren't interviewing a nurse," said one of the producers after hearing my proposal. "This is a story about nursing shortages, and you aren't interviewing a nurse." The meeting fell silent. To me, it felt like the moment in the Hans Christian Andersen story, The Emperor's New Clothes, when the child cries out that the emperor is naked. I could feel my face flushing with embarrassment and my thinking frontal lobes being taken offline. I was acutely sensitized to the producer's comment because it was the second time recently that she had raised an objection in a still small voice that seemed to pack a wallop. Later in the book, I'll show you a technique used by comedy improv partners to support one another on stage. Intentionally or not, the objection raised by the producer was not constructed to support my idea. The thing is, up until that meeting, the producer and I had worked quite well together, which made these perceived critical barbs surprising. So surprising that in the first instance, I was unable to respond. But on this second occasion, something very different happened. In addition to feeling embarrassment, I kept my higher centers functioning by being curious. I remembered the times when the producer and I had worked well together. Recently, the show had changed leaders. Perhaps the barb was less about sending a message to me and more about showing the new leader that she was capable of critical thinking. "I know that it's important to get the viewpoint of nurses when doing a story about nursing shortages," I replied. "That's a great story idea that I dearly want to do on the show. But the leader asked us to pitch stories not on the nursing shortage and reasons why, but on the impact of nursing shortages." Then I uttered three words that I had never used before in a story meeting. "Tell me more," I found myself asking. Those three words disarmed the barbs by asking for the critical thinking behind them. The producer began to elaborate on the original criticism. Instead of feeling threatened, I expressed appreciation to her for anticipating criticisms we might get from our listeners and from nurses. We began to support one another. We recognized one another's gifts. We became a team. As you'll find out later in the book, the words "tell me more" are part of a team-building technique called Visual Thinking Strategies, VTS, which creates a safe structure that empowers all members of the team to contribute to meetings. I've spent close to four decades as a frontline emergency physician. When it comes to teamwork, healthcare is a special case, and I know a fair amount about modern medical culture. Almost every head nurse, dean of medicine, or hospital executive I've met uses lofty rhetoric to extol the virtues of teamwork. Today's healthcare organizations are filled with skilled, multi-generational, and culturally diverse interdisciplinary team members, wrote Charlotte Davis, a surgical trauma ICU nurse educator and clinical adjunct faculty member at Clayton State University, in a 2017 article for Nursing Made Incredibly Easy. Although each specialty has a specific focus, we all share a unified goal. We want both the patient care experience and our work environment to be positive. To ensure that patients are satisfied during their healthcare encounter, we must embrace a teamwork approach to care delivery. People in healthcare constantly talk up the benefits of teamwork while failing to comprehend what that means. This manifests itself in many ways. For example, ask different health professionals about the team spiritedness at hospitals, and you'll get some very different answers. Dr. Martin McCary and colleagues found that out when they surveyed operating room personnel at 60 hospitals across the United States for a study published in the Journal of the American College of Surgeons in 2006. Surgeons rated the quality of collaboration and communication by fellow surgeons as high or very high 85% of the time. Nurses, on the other hand, rated their collaboration with surgeons as high or very high just 48% of the time. Clearly, there's a disconnect between surgeons and nurses. Some of that may be due to some misconceptions about teamwork that need to be clarified. In a high-performance cardiovascular operating room, the lead surgeon performs the organ transplant. The first assistant surgeon keeps the field of view free from blood. The anesthesiologist keeps the patient alive and unconscious on a ventilator. And the scrub nurse hands the surgeons instruments and, with other nurses, maintains a strict count of said instruments. But a shared goal is fundamental. Everyone must feel as if they are joined in a common mission or struggle, or they don't function as a team. Healthcare isn't about winning championships. It's the business of curing illness, repairing trauma, and saving lives. When it's you or a loved one on the table in the OR, the stakes could not be greater. When I set out to write my fourth nonfiction book, I had no intention of writing about the elemental need for teamwork in healthcare. Then, a man named Martin Bromley told me a story that completely changed my mind. Martin Bromley has been a commercial airline pilot for more than a quarter of a century. He's accumulated just over 11,000 hours flying the Airbus A319, A320, and A321 for a major international airline based in the UK. As a training captain, he gets to instruct newly minted pilots in the simulator and in a real cockpit. As an accomplished aviator and aviation instructor, Martin is steeped in knowledge about the power of teamwork. His interest is not just professional, but deeply personal. This is because of his late wife, Elaine Bromley. High school sweethearts, the couple met when Elaine was 16 and Martin 3 years older. "She was very different to anybody else I'd met at that stage," says Martin. "She was full of life, very bubbly. She was probably more adventurous and more happy to travel, whereas I was quite reserved, I think." Opposites attract, and Martin says he and Elaine hit it off straight away. They got married in 1989 in a little church near Aylesbury in Buckinghamshire. Elaine worked in the travel industry, and the couple honeymooned in Hawaii. Their daughter, Victoria, was born in 1999 and their son, Adam, in 2001. In 2004, Elaine caught a bad cold and developed a sinus infection. That led to a severe bout of periorbital cellulitis, an infection of the skin and soft tissues that surround the eyes. It's not a trivial infection. Complications include protrusion of the eyeball and meningitis. Elaine was admitted to hospital for IV antibiotics and recovered. It turns out she had a deviated septum that caused the sinus passages on one side of her face to get blocked. "She saw a consultant in the hospital," says Martin. "And he said, 'I think we need to sort this out because otherwise you're going to be back in hospital again.' So that was where the plan came from, as it were." The ear, nose, and throat ENT surgeon booked Elaine for a functional endoscopic sinus surgery and a septoplasty. The plan was to straighten the cartilage between her nostrils to improve her breathing and the drainage of her sinuses and thus make her less prone to sinusitis. Endoscopic surgery is a form of keyhole or minimally invasive surgery performed entirely through the nostrils. The surgeon uses an endoscope, which is a thin camera rod with a light at the end, to illuminate, visualize, and magnify the sinus tissues. The images are sent to a large video screen in the OR. The surgeon uses specialized instruments to cut and remove tissue blocking the sinuses, such as nasal polyps and scar tissue, to straighten the septum, and to reduce the size of the turbinates, projections made of cartilage that sometimes block the nasal passages. The procedure takes 30 to 90 minutes and can be done at a hospital, a doctor's office, or a clinic. Since the operation does not involve cutting through the skin on the face, there's often very little postoperative pain. Most people go home the same day. the procedure is done under local or general anesthesia. It so happened I was going to be off for 2 weeks at the start of Easter, Martin recalls. It made sense to have the procedure done at the start of that 2 weeks off so I could look after the kids. The surgery was booked for March 29th, 2005. I don't think I was particularly nervous, he says. If your partner goes into hospital, it's a bit nerve-wracking. But I didn't expect anything to go wrong. Martin says they woke up at 6:15 the morning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.